Okay, folks, welcome. Thanks for staying on. Now for something completely different again, to get you in a different sort of zone. So I'm here with my colleague Tom Burke, who is a documentary filmmaker, but he's also an academic, a fledgling academic like myself. So we're sort of just going to talk about a film that he made that has a very... It's a climate change film, so we just want to talk it. So I'm going to start by asking just, Tom, how you came up with this idea for the documentary. Just give us a narrative of how this film evolved.
Yeah, I'll start with... Is this on? Is that working?
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. I'll give you a little preamble, and then what I think we're going to do is we're going to watch the first 4 or 5 minutes of the film, which kind of set up the situation. But for context, I was reading about this village in the Guardian newspaper in late 2013. Their main environment correspondent, Suzanne Goldberg, had gone there several times and was kind of tracking the challenges in the village. And the challenge is primarily one of coastal erosion. Okay, so the headline is, here is a village that's losing X number of feet, X number of meters of land each year, land literally falling into the sea because the permafrost is melting and is eroding away. And she did a series of articles that were very vivid. They were very well written and very vivid and full of characters. And I found myself kind of picking up on them every few weeks, and this village, Newtok, and it's a very interesting name. It's the only place called Newtok. And so I kind of followed it, and then eventually she went there on one of her trips. She went with a photographer and came back with these images, and I was really excited by the look of the place. So her reporting was great. The pictures were good, but they were still pictures. And I thought, okay, here is a place that has a very interesting story with several different layers to it, and it's got a very, I'll admit, I'm thinking cinematically, I'm like, if you go there with a camera, you're gonna get some very strong images. So that kind of mixture of attraction is what brought me there. That's the backstory.
And if you want to flesh it out a bit more, I don't know if there's any filmmakers in the auditorium, but look, how did you get funding for this? Or how did you sort of get the wherewithal to actually kick off the story? Was it a labor of love, or was it something, another piece of work that you...
No, it's very much a labor of love, I think, because really you're working on a film like this for 4 years, and really there's no money until about year three. Mm-hmm. So there's 7 trips to Alaska. I think 3 of those would have been self-funded. So money, if there's any fledgling documentary filmmakers in the room, I hope you don't like money. somebody said that to me when I was about 22. They said, you can do things that are much less complicated for more money. And that remains true. The funding, it's worth saying, I'll tell you a story about funding after we watch something. A project like this can only happen because of Screen Ireland, because the funding that Screen Ireland offer, firstly, there's development funding, which is no strings attached, kind of go and have a go funding. See if you can, if this story has legs. There's no broadcaster will give you that type of funding. So it's a small amount. It tops out at 15,000, but there are no strings attached. And that is absolutely crucial when you're developing a doc, is particularly one that's so far away, to go, right, is this what I think it is? Will these people talk to me? If I get there, can I operate? Can I film? And is the story that I think is here, is that actually the story that's here? Or indeed, is there a more interesting story here or other elements to it? So will we watch a little bit?
Let's watch a bit of it.
Okay. So just to set this up, this is really the opening kind of 4 or 5 minutes of the film, which I think is useful because it shows you the village visually, and then it kind of sets up that core coastal erosion problem.
the gold and silver being stolen away. Picture Turner looking east and west from the dark room of his mind. He made to Kansas City, 12th Street and Vine. Nothing standing there. I want to hear the word. I want to rise in the shacks are sliding down. Folks lose their possessions, the folks are leaving town. Bertha Mason shook it, broke it, then she hung it on the wall. Say you're dancing with whom they tell you to, well, you don't dance at all. It's tough out there. I want to everywhere. I got a craving love for blazing speed, got a hopped up Mustang Ford. Jump into the wagon, love, throw your panties overboard. I can write you poems, make a strong man lose his mind. I'm no pig without a wig, I hope you treat me kind. Things are breaking up out there. I want to hurt you well. High water rising, 6 inches above my head. Coffins dropping in the street like balloons made out of lead. What I poured into Vicksburg, don't know what I'm gonna do. Don't reach out for me, she say, can't you see I'm drowning too? It's rough out there. High water everywhere. Well, George Lewis told the Englishman, the Italian and the Jew, you can't open up your mind, boys, to every conceivable point of view. They got Charles Darwin trapped out there on Highway 5. Judge says to the high sheriff, I want him dead or alive. Either one, I don't care. High water everywhere.
I don't need to tell people here in Alaska what's happening. Over the past few years, I've been trying to make the rest of the country more aware of a changing climate, but you're already living it. Thawing permafrost that threatens homes and infrastructure, faster glacier melt, rising seas, melting sea ice that contributes to some of the fastest coastal erosion in the world. And I've talked to folks whose villages are literally in danger of slipping away. And for many of those Alaskans, it's no longer a question of if they're going to relocate, but when.
And my grandfather, he used to say, this new talk will become one big island. It's already an island. We've got river around us. And when the high wind comes in, it's like this one big island surrounded by the water. Water. Feel like it's getting danger every time it gets close. Because who knows, this one big village can come out snap. Because we're on the permafrost, And this new talk, it's really heavy, you know. When this land keeps coming off, the ice, the land, you know.
Fantastic. I just want everyone to be aware of that we're going to have a Q&A after we finish some of these sessions, so have some questions if you want to ask Tom. But, I mean, immediately it comes to mind here, it's like a road movie. And, you know, did you script it in advance? Did you know what you were filming?
Nope.
So no sort of, I'm thinking of people like, we have issues with Robert Flaherty coming to Ireland and spending a year on Aran Islands and filming everything. Did you film an awful lot and have a very high shooting ratio, or did you have any ideas of the sort of shots you wanted?
I think, without going down a Robert Flaherty hole, I think the great trick of documentary and kind of the privilege of documentary is that you go there with the things you think you know, and then you're confronted by the reality of the situation and you adapt very quickly to what's actually in front of you. So I think I would have learned on previous projects to be very careful with your pre-existing assumptions about what the story is. Yeah. So I land in the village and I meet Raman and I'm like, oh, I know about coastal erosion, but I know that little bit that I know, but he has to show me. And then I have to live there and I have to kind of experience the village. And actually then you're attracted there. There's an early interview with a guy called Harold Borbridge, and I interviewed him on like day three because he was very engaging. He was very interested in the fact that somebody had come from Ireland. And so we started doing the interview and we got in a couple of minutes and he's like, did you really come all the way here to talk about coastal erosion? You know, when are we going to do the real interview? I said, well, what's the real interview? The corruption. Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, tell me about the corruption. And so that unfolds then. So Harold opens that door for you, and then you walk through that and you talk to other people and it opens up. And what's interesting is the format of feature documentary, you know you're going to have to engage for a long time. You know there's going to be multiple trips. The village were somewhat used to a news crew coming in from Anchorage, say, and spending a day and talk about erosion or a health clinic or, a local news story. And so they're used to kind of being nice to white journalist types who come in. They'll tolerate you for a day or so, and then off you go. So I had, the first trip was 10 days, and on day three, they're like, are you still here? The Irish guy is still here. Why is the Irish guy still here? So they're okay, so he's not just doing a news report. Fine. I'm leaving after that trip, and I say, I'll be back in the summertime when it's not so frozen. Yeah, sure. Yeah, okay, good luck. And I came back in the summer, and they were like, oh, you came back. I was leaving that trip, and I said, I'm going to come back next spring. Yeah, sure. And then when I came back next spring, they were like, okay, this person is actually interested. And it was on the third trip then, that was the first time anybody made me dinner. That was the first time I got to use somebody else's honey bucket, which we'll get to. Then the access opened up because they're like, okay, this person has come from Ireland, and a lot of them wouldn't know where Ireland is. So they recognized that actually I was in for the long haul. And then the access opens up.
Yeah, the president this morning talked about the need for anthropology in higher education. I think that's a good example of it, that's right, in Gracia, to connect with. Can you tell us a bit more about the Obama as the backstory or as the context? Was that something you sort of decided to put that hook on it, or was that an aesthetic decision, or how did you?
It just so happened. So I started filming in March 2015. And the second trip was July 2015, which seems like a long time ago now. Obama went to Alaska in September 2015. So after I had done my first two trips and I had some momentum. And he went and he did a 3-day tour of Alaska. And he went he didn't go quite to this area, but he went further north to a place called Kotzebue. He also hung out with Bear Grylls for a day.
Who's he?
But he gave that speech in Kotzebue in Alaska, and like you couldn't have written a better script for, just setting up the problem. And I think Obama is quite good at public speaking. And so it worked as, so the film is bookended with Barack Obama setting up the problem, and then he kind of makes predictions for the future at the end, which by the time the film comes out, are kind of bitter sweet because we already have Trump at that point.
And the music, very strong lyrical music, was that chosen just after the event? Was that a post-production decision, or where did that come?
the music for me, I work with a composer called Jerry Horan, who lives about 500 yards from here. On all of my films, I tend to talk to Jerry before I talk to anybody else. So I would have spoken to Jerry before I got on a plane. I would have showed him the pictures from The Guardian. And then when I came back from my first trip, which was a March trip, so everything was frozen, I showed him all the rushes, and Jerry started working at that point. So Jerry, in fairness to Jerry, he worked on the music for 3 or 3.5 years. There's a lot of music in it, and music plays a big role in the film. And I might have to apologize to some filmmakers or to some documentary people, because, you know, it's the imposition of music very much on that music is not audible in the village. But that it's a filmmaking choice, and I'm happy with it.
Are there any other aesthetic decisions you had to make when you were doing the production that you think were unusual for this production, or was it seamless in even though you had to go a lot of times to get this footage?
The hardest thing, and this relates to something we talked about last week, the most difficult thing was I did it all by myself. So I traveled alone. And so I could only bring what I could carry.
Yeah.
I could only bring what United Airlines would allow me to bring as a single person. On one of the trips, so it's as small a camera bag as I can manage, plus a tripod, no lights. It's all very minimal. Most of it is handheld. Most of it is shot on two lenses. So everything is very minimal. On one of the trips, there was one trip that involved a Steadicam and a helicopter, and that nearly broke me. So to anyone who knows what a Steadicam looks like, I managed to get one into the village, but I will never do that again.
Yeah, I mean, from a climate change perspective, your carbon calculator, your carbon footprint was kept quite low because of you just went yourself. It's almost a dogma-style aesthetic for environmental filmmaking to keep it low, not have extra resources that are not needed.
Yeah, now, like, I'd love to claim that it was for carbon footprint reasons, but it was kind of selfish. It's budgetary on the one hand, because each trip is a minimum 5,000 euro.
Wow.
5, 6, 7, depending on the time of year, particularly in winter, because it's not a very popular, there's not a lot of people going from Dublin to Western Alaska. It's 5 flights to get from Dublin to the village, with the plane getting smaller and smaller on each leg. So there's budgetary reasons, which is to send me is 5 grand, to send the normal crew of 3 is 15. So do you go once with 3 people, or do you go 3 times with 1 person? So I chose the former. And then also selfishly, I wanted to be on my own. I thought, if I'm on my own, from experience of filming in other countries, I find that if you go on your own, people are more likely to talk to you and mind you and look after you and engage with you. And I've seen it with other crews where they show up 2 or 3 of them and they're just left alone because, you know, they can do their thing.
And did you do any desk research before? Did you have any environmental consultant sort of know about the issue, or what sort of what money shots you might want to get to really make it effective? I mean, we're going to see some really good shots later on. Did you sort of look at other documentaries from the region, or did you do any recces that way?
No, I'm a bit funny that way, in that I don't want I would consciously not look at other films from that region, because I don't want to be led by that.
Yeah.
So my pitch to Screen Ireland, I had made a film in 2009 called The Liberties, about the neighborhood in Dublin. And I was basically pitching this as The Liberties on the Tundra. That it's actually a film about community. So climate change is kind of the backdrop and the context, and it's the thing that's pushing them. But actually it's about, how do you live in that place? How do you live in a village of 350 people and watch it fall away, and then plan to move over there, and then fight and all of that. So really it's about community, hopefully.
Do you need to set up the next sequence, or just
We're just a shorter sequence about at the time he was a young man in the village. He's not young anymore. Bosco Charles. Bosco wrote a Facebook post, I think the year I arrived, but before I had met him, and it was kind of a plea on behalf of the village, and it went viral kind of within the Native Village network in Alaska. So it was a way to, again, when you're doing a documentary, you don't want to be scripting things because that's not really the job. So in a way, Bosco kind of wrote the script for his own sequence, and then we visualized it together.
Yeah, there was a tsunami in my dream. Like a big flood. It was scary. Just recently, like last year.
Hello, my name is Bosco Charles. I am 19 years old and I am from a small village called Newtok. I go to a school that has 137 students. I am writing about a village trying to move because of climate change. Newtok is a small place that has about 350 people in it. We are trying to move to a place called Mukhtavik, that's about 9 miles out of Newtok. I have been in Newtok basically all my life and it has always been the same every year. We lose a number of feet of land each year. What is not the same each year is the extent of the erosion because the weather isn't the same each year. Sometimes it cooperates with us, but most of the time it doesn't. In 2003, we lost 150 feet of land from water washing away land. The nearest home to the water is about 100 yards. We are going to have a disaster if we don't move. We need to act as soon as possible before the water gets to us or it will eat us like Cookie Monster eating cookies. It just falls. The land just falls down and it cannot pick itself up. I strongly believe we can do this, but we will need help. This place is very important to us because of how much hunting we do, how much we move around a whole lot. But the hardest thing we have to face is having no running water or sewer lines. We use honey buckets, which is a 5-gallon bucket for human waste. Then we dump it out into the water when it is full. According to the government, it's about $130 million. Climate change is like playing chess, and it has checkmated us. Please, we need to make a move because we have a possibility we might lose this battle. We just want to sit at a table with no worries, just like everyone else, and just have a cup of tea, laughing away with our cousins. Life is too short to see us swimming to the nearest village. That's about 40 miles, and the water is too cold. I'm done.
Fantastic. I mean, obviously, telling stories is what climate change can be very good, and we need to tell more of. I think we should open it up to public now. Is there anyone that has questions?
I'm just going to say one more thing before we. So that sequence, that was cut probably in year two, and in year two, this is about kind of the difficulty of funding a story like this and of telling a story like this, which requires money. There isn't really a way to do a project like this without some money. So a major U.S. broadcaster, who I won't name, was interested in year one. They were interested in the proposal. They were interested in some of the early imagery. There were two Skype calls in year one, good enough to establish an in-person meeting in Sheffield in year two. And, you know, lots of excitement, lots of buzz. And then we sat down for the meeting. Great, how's it going? My wife tells me not to do an impersonation of this person's accent, so I won't.
We'll allow for therapy later.
I've got a mic in my hand and there's an audience, so it's very hard. This person sat down. He's full of enthusiasm. Again, major US broadcaster. This would have unlocked a whole path. Great, how's it going? Great, I've just come back from another trip. We've cut a sequence. Great. I open up the Bosco sequence and put the laptop in front of him and press play, and I see his face starting like this, and when Bosco comes on screen, his face drops, and he goes, oh, is this a native village? I said, yeah, that's, you know, it's in all the, it's called New Talk, it's in all the proposals. He's like, oh, that's a problem. I said, I thought your viewers, you said, this is from the last Skype call, you said your viewers love seeing people do things in Alaska. They love seeing white people do things in Alaska.
Okay, says it all.
And that was the end of the meeting. So it's okay. Again, that's a shout out to Screen Ireland, because we are not encumbered with that type of stuff. Sorry, I just had to get that in. We'll throw it open.
We'll get the Freudians to sort you out later on. Okay, any question and answers? There must be some questions from the audience. Just put up your hand. Anyone got a question for Tom? Yeah, Duncan on this over here. Duncan.
Pass the parcel.
Thanks, Tom. It's really engaging. Wonderful. You know, I produce television documentaries. But the issue there of the climate impacts there, do you bring the story? Now, obviously, there's the human story, there's the village, there's the melting of the permafrost and the erosion of the coast, all these local issues that are so pertinent. But do you bring it to the wider issues of the permafrost in terms of what's coming down the track with releasing all of this methane, this massive amount? Do you go into that story at all? Because I just wonder, do you bring it to that level, you know, or do you keep it at the local story?
That's a good question. So in, you know yourself, in a long production process like that, you follow various threads. And I did widen it at certain points. So I interviewed a congressperson. I interviewed the governor of Alaska. I did interview they've got a place called the Center for Cold Climate Housing Research in Fairbanks. So I talked to them about the mechanics of permafrost. And basically I found that every time I widened the view beyond the village, I got less interested. There is that film to be made which gives you that macro overview, but I ended up, as a creative decision, to keep my focus in the village. I did the interview with the governor and I thought, okay, this could be a way to broaden it out. But I interviewed the governor of Alaska and he kept getting the name of the village wrong, which is revealing in itself, but it wasn't of interest to me. So I think there are other people who are better at that type of storytelling, but that wasn't for me.
Okay, no. Sive, just here in the front here.
Hi there. Thanks so much, Tom and Pat. President Higgins, when he was addressing us earlier, spoke about the need to include philosophy and anthropology in the kind of range of disciplines that we bring together to look at climate change. And I would add to that there is a need for some sort of psychological input, because the loss that this particular little clip, that I've only seen the clips, not the full film, the loss that it's describing is immense. And I just wonder what you think about the role of film and documentary in helping not just communities like that process their loss, their imminent loss, but the rest of us, and because we become these spectators to losses that are going to happen elsewhere, at least initially. And it's heartbreaking. And it's also, the worry from the activist side is that, does it empower us to act? Does it get us to engage? Or does it just make us feel really terrible and not know what to do?
Yeah. So, yeah, what is the purpose? What is the purpose of a documentary about a small village? I think to speak in favor of something like this, which is a feature documentary, I think what it can do is show you kind of like the long read as opposed to the news report. It can show you something over the longer period of time, and it can show the pattern, and it can track a story over a longer period of time, so that we don't get, you know, we're all in our news feeds all the time, and there's a constant refresh of little bite-sized bits of information. I think the longer reads, the longer films, the longer projects have the potential to give us a deeper understanding and maybe to show patterns of behavior over time. I was careful early on. This was never to be a campaigning film. An early producer was like, you know, is there a call to action at the end, or is there a happy ending? There is no happy ending in this film, consciously. The film, for those who haven't seen it, the film kind of ends with a kind of a whimper, because some people get to move across the river to higher ground and safety, and some people do not. Now, I finished it in 2017, 2018, and again, I fretted about, should I put some kind of an ending on it to give some kind of closure? But the truth is, it's now 2022, and I was speaking to Harold and Raman last week, and still less than half the village have moved across. So, to the new site. The new site is working quite well, but the old village is just as full of rubbish and is as neglected as it was in 2018. So sometimes I thought it would have been dishonest to kind of give it an ending and a call to action or something, because I don't necessarily think that's my role.
We're running a bit late. Yeah. Thank you very much, Tom. Can the film be seen anywhere, or is it visible?
The film, yes, as of last week, the film can be seen on the Irish Film Institute's IFI at Home player. Okay. There is a compromised 52-minute version on the RT player, which is fine. And then, actually, if you're in Ireland, you can see it everywhere. It's on iTunes, and it's on Google Play, and it's on Volta. So, yes. Right, I recommend it.
Of course it is. I think we'll join. Just thank you, Tom, for fascinating doing for that.